Hi, I'm Jess Hall. I'm the Chief Product Officer of Just Eat Takeaway. I am here to represent.
What does a day in the life of a Chief Product Officer look like?
The first thing to say is there's no day the same. There's no typical day in my role. It's so broad. I can be looking at courier things. I can be looking at the app that the customers use. But that's just the product part. I'm also very engaged in training and career frameworks and how our team works, the health of the organization, our budgeting, our hiring numbers, and all of the elements that make running a department possible. And then, of course, I play a wider role in the Just Eat Takeaway business in the executive committee as part of the team that's leading the business overall. So every day is different, but that's why I love it, because I get to be involved in so many different things.
Please can you tell us about your early career and how it got you to where you are today?
So I didn't really study STEM, and I certainly didn't at university. I always had an interest in it, and I did an IT A-level, or I actually changed school so that I could do it. So I always had an interest, but I'm not a computer scientist. And I went to university and I studied business. There was a whole variety, which I really enjoyed, but no tech. And when I left university and I was looking at, like, what should I do? Where do I want to go? I came across the Tesco graduate scheme, which was a tech scheme, but they were open to taking people from different backgrounds and training us. And that was the best opportunity for me. It was a brilliant opportunity. I learned so much, and I did learn code there with them. I did write code, but unlike most of you watching, I was terrible at it, so I didn't stick at that for very long. But it gave me a really good insight, and I'm very interested in the topics of technology and the applications of technology and how it can be used. So I spent much of my career kind of very close to the computer science side of things, but in the delivery side of things. So I worked as a business analyst for a time, like really getting into detail. I've worked as a project and program manager. I've worked in product. So I've always been around this space. And over the years, I've taught myself bits and pieces. The last thing I learned was Python. Still not very good at it, but I did learn it. I've taught myself JavaScript. I've done a few bits over the years for my own interest. But I've had the opportunity to be close to tech without having to have that computer science background. And I think that's really important, especially for women, because it wasn't that I was discouraged from a STEM learning path, but it also wasn't really encouraged for me either. So I did a whole variety of things, and I didn't really understand that I might be closing off a career path for the future, or what I would need to do, or even what a role in tech might look like for me. Even now, I think it's very hard to explain to a young person, like, what is product management and what would the job be like, and why does it matter? So I've always been close to it, always been interested, but I've kind of sidestepped into it, and I count myself as very lucky for being able to do that.
JustEatTakeaway.com now operates in 20 markets across the world. How do you use customer data and technology to help you scale in different markets?
I think customer data is really important to us, and customer data spans lots of different areas. So it isn't just about the food that people order or the time that they order it. It's also data on the other side. How long does it take us to deliver food to you? And the data around that side of the service. So we have to build up a picture of the whole experience for the customer. And we, you know, need to be thinking about how to make that better all the time. And data is a great way of informing us on that. You know, customers want their food as fast as possible. So using the data around ETAs, how long it takes us to assign a courier, how long it takes the courier to get to you. There's loads of data in that about you know, how we can improve that, how we can make it a better customer experience. So it's very, very critical. And we spend a lot of time doing, you know, analytics and looking at what the data is telling us, how our products are performing, and also, you know, then what features do we think we should develop? And I like to say it's data informed. So all of the work we do, we will look at the data to see what story it's telling us and help us make the decision about how to implement features or whether they're going to be valuable to our customers. So very important, very, very important.
Smart tech is now the norm and ordering a pizza with your phone is second nature. How do you see this industry evolving in the next 5 years?
It's great though. Like, I think that's something that's come out of COVID as well, you know, a different perspective on some of those things because we were stuck at home for so long. So where the breakfast market was smaller pre-COVID, it's grown a lot and it's something that customers really love and they're sticking with even though we're now not as restricted as we were. So it'll be interesting to see how habits change over time. And again, that's where the customer data is really important to us.
In what way is JustEatTakeaway.com using robotics?
Robotics is a really interesting one for us. It depends if you're talking about like actual robotics or robots, like drone delivery. We're experimenting with robotic delivery in the US. And I think there's some really interesting stuff there. And we also know, don't we, that robotics and AI is becoming ever more present in our everyday life with self-driving cars and things like that. So the application of that I see only growing in our lives, and I see no reason why that won't take a bigger and bigger role in the technology that we use in food delivery industry. There's also kind of the robotic process automation side of things and looking at how we can provide better experiences for customers through that type of technology, and that's something that I'd like to see more of.
As you climb higher in management, do you spend less time being hands-on with the technology?
I think credit to Tesco on this one, that they were really clear that they were looking for people with potential, so the background didn't matter, and that did give me the confidence to apply and go forward. I think if you don't have that background but you want to get into it, the best thing that you can do is do your research on the industry, understand how technology is being applied, how that company might be using technology, what's out there about the way that they work, and use that, because ultimately it's less about the theory and more about the application in reality. And so the more you can understand the context and join the dots between things, the more easily you're going to solve problems. And ultimately, if you're writing code, if you're a product manager, if you're doing analytics, anything you're doing in this space is about problem solving, is about connecting the dots, and is about figuring out then how to move forward and solve that problem. If you are listening to this and thinking, well, that's fine for her because she was really confident, she knew what she was doing. I didn't. I've developed my confidence throughout my career, and I still have days now when I think, oh my gosh, can I do this? It's natural to doubt yourself, and women are much more likely to do that. But I wasn't this confident person who knew exactly what she was doing. I've learned it and I've developed my capability and my comfort zone over time.
Sponsorship and mentorship, what impact does that have?
This is a topic that I'm incredibly passionate about, understanding the impact of sponsorship. What I mean by sponsorship is, you know, spending some of your reputation on somebody else, taking a chance on them, backing them, and giving them the space to succeed. It is so important, and it happens all the time. Men tend to sponsor men because actually there's a few biases that come into it, you know, affinity bias, we tend to like people who are like us, and then confirmation bias, that I hired this person because they were like me and they were good at the job, so that's given me the confirmation bias that I did the right thing. And then you can see how that perpetuates over time. So as women, because there were fewer women in positions of power or hiring, etc., that just doesn't happen as much in a natural way. So we need to be much more aware of it. And I'm also not saying perpetuate this, you know, in a way that only benefits women. Look at the people around you, look at the organization, and think about who you can help raise up, who has potential. It doesn't have to be only women, but we need to be aware and making decisions about it. I have 100% benefited from sponsorship, particularly after I returned to work after my first child. I had really lost confidence. It was hard to return. You know, I felt like I'd been out of the organisation for a really long time. I felt like I didn't know things, and it just, it was really tough, and I wasn't really sure which direction to turn. And I was very fortunate to meet and work for somebody who truly sponsored me and helped me see what my skills were, develop my confidence, create a role for me that actually helped me thrive. And, you know, if I think about my career trajectory as a line from the start to where I am now, that moment, that time when he sponsored me, was a massive uptick in my personal career growth, and I'm incredibly grateful for it. But that's why I talk about it so passionately, because it can have such an impact. And if you're watching this and you're thinking, yeah, that's fine, but I'm not a manager, or I'm not hiring people, I'm at the beginning of my career, it starts with mentoring and it grows to giving opportunities. In between those things, you can help people strategize. You can introduce them to people that they wouldn't necessarily normally meet. All of those things are small examples of sponsorship. Because what you're doing is you're just giving somebody more opportunity to succeed, or more opportunity to see the context and connect the dots, like I spoke about earlier.
What advice would you give to women trying to balance family commitments and a career in tech?
What I would say is, first of all, it is temporary, and you can soon get back to where you were. I've had two children. The first time I returned to the same organisation. The second time I left while I was on maternity leave and I went to a new organisation. And so I've had two very different experiences, but both times, with a bit of time, I've settled in and I've learnt the lay of the land, and I've been able to perform. It's critical that you ask questions and you don't feel afraid to ask what's changed, or why are we doing this, or, you know, what do I need to know? It's critical that you build up your network again. If people have left that you relied on before, identify some people to build a relationship with. If your network's still pretty good, then lean on that network to help understand things, help them, use them to help you with challenges that you're facing, so that you've got somebody to bounce ideas off in a safe way to help you build that confidence. And I'd also really recommend that you contract with your manager about your return, or if you're starting a new job. You've got to do this in a way that you're comfortable with. But I was very emotional when I returned to work. I found that, you know, like little things would make me cry. And it's really embarrassing when that happens at work. And we all wish it didn't. And to be honest, I am a crier and I still cry about things sometimes now. But I said to my manager at the time, I'm feeling really emotional and I will cry about some stuff. It's not because I'm sad. It might be because I'm angry. I need you to understand that I will explain to you why I'm crying, but please don't put your version of why I'm crying on this situation. I'm telling you now before it happens. If you feel strong enough, I recommend having those conversations so that you can really build that relationship to get the support that you need. It will take some people by surprise and they won't be ready for that conversation, but you will know that you've done everything you can to set yourself up. And in time, it just gets easier. When it comes to balancing your life, I want to tell you can have it all. You can, but you have to know that it's a blend, and you've got to make your choices about what matters to you. And that's a really key piece of advice.
What advice would you give to women wanting to make a career switch to tech with no previous tech experience?
In large organisations, yes, you might work on a smaller piece of the picture, but you can still have huge impact. But if you're a big picture kind of thinker and that's what motivates you, perhaps a smaller organisation is a better fit for you. And in those organisations, you can still get exposure to lots of different elements of those businesses. And perhaps you can find one that's got a purpose that really resonates with you. I think the most important thing to know is, what is it that gives you energy? What is it that motivates you? When you leave your desk at the end of the day, what are you proud of, and do you feel like you're getting that? And you can get that in any organisation. You just got to know yourself, and that's the most important thing. And if I can give you some advice, I would say, like, get to know those things that give you energy, get to know those things that make you feel excited or proud of your work, because then you will identify opportunities that help you get more of that.
If you could share one word of wisdom to your younger self, what would it be?
I think the advice I would give is probably in two parts. One, resilience is going to be your greatest strength. Understanding how to look after yourself and how to have that inner strength to keep going is the thing that's going to propel you forward. And my second piece of advice, which some of you might identify with, is don't rush. Spend the time to know the work and be ready to move on, because that is what will help you in the long term. So even though people seem to be getting on faster than you or achieving things more quickly or easily, it doesn't matter. Know your stuff and it will take you forward. And I am the evidence of that. I didn't necessarily proceed at the same speed as the graduates who were on the same graduate scheme as me. And I sometimes felt like I was behind, but I'm really proud of what I've achieved. And to get to being chief product officer of a large organization like this is a job that I wanted my whole career. And I've achieved that. It didn't hold me back, the fact that it took me maybe longer to get out of the starting blocks.